Good morning and welcome to the third week of our course, The American Revolution in Art and Society. My name is Kristen Hoskins and I'm the curator of lectures, courses, and concerts. Today's lecture is A Republic of Letters, Writing, Virtue, and the Forging of an American Nation, presented by Dennis Carr, Carolyn and Peter Lynch, curator of American Decorative Arts and Sculpture in the Art of the Americas here at the MFA. Carr was co-curator of the MFA's award-winning 53-gallery Art of the Americas Wing and a contributing author to the books A New World Imagined, Art of the Americas, Painting a Map of 16th Century Mexico City, Land Writing and Native Rule, Made in the Americas, The New World Discovers Asia, and Art and Industry, Rhode Island Furniture, 1650 to 1830. He holds graduate degrees from Yale University in the History of Art and the Winterthur Program in Early American Culture. He recently organized the critically acclaimed exhibition at the MFA, Made in the Americas, The New World Discovers Asia, which was awarded grants by the National Endowment for the Humanities and the Terra Foundation for American Art. Thank you so much for joining us today, and please join me in welcoming our speaker, Dennis Carr.
Thank you very much, Kristen. Welcome, everybody. Thanks for coming today. I hope that you've been enjoying this course on the American Revolution and the look at how objects shape the material culture of the early Americas during this period. So far, you've heard about tea drinking and sugar consumption. You've heard about the Liberty Bowl. And next week, you'll hear about painting. This week, we're going to talk about writing and its importance during the 17th and 18th centuries. Specifically, we're going to talk about writing desks, which were a newfangled form of furniture that were that was produced in these two centuries, the late 17th into the 18th century, and see how the production of writing desks and just the act of writing in general mirrored the rising gentility of society in the Americas. So I want to begin today with one of my favorite paintings. It's called The Bermuda Group, or Dean Berkeley, or Barkley, as it's correctly pronounced, and his entourage, which was painted by John Smybert, a Boston artist, in 1728 and completed in 1739. It's now at the Yale University Art Gallery, a gift in 1808. Dean Barkley was an Anglican minister and philosopher and writer who wanted to found a seminary in Bermuda. And he gathered together a small group of people, including some teachers and some wealthy aristocrats who were funding the project, and they sailed across the Atlantic, arriving in Newport, Rhode Island, January 23rd, 1729. Now, Smybert had already begun the outlines for this painting. He had been commissioned by the man who's seated at the table, John Wainwright, who didn't make the trip with Barkley and his entourage, but nevertheless appears in this painting. He's seated at the table. He was a lawyer by training, and he's copying down, presumably, what Barkley is saying. He's acting as the scribe for this little group. So on the left, standing in the background, is the painter John Smybert, who did accompany the group. This voyage brought him to America and set him up as one of the early artists, very important artists, portraitists especially, working in Boston. So this venture was not ultimately a success. The promised funding from Parliament never came through, and by 1731, Barkley returned to England, not having set up this seminary in Bermuda. But he ended up spending a couple of years in the Newport area, and he actually bought and added on to a house, which is still there today, called Whitehall in Middletown, Rhode Island, which is just north of Newport. And he donated his entire collection of books to Harvard and to Yale. So he split the collection of books, and it became a huge gift of books for both of these universities. And he gave his farm where he lived in Middletown to Yale. And it's through these connections that Yale ended up with this masterful painting, which is, I think, the largest and certainly the most ambitious painting prior to the mid-18th century in America. But I wanted to show it to you today to think about the idea of community building and how that goes with writing in the 18th century. So I've just started to read a book by Jane Kaminsky about Copley. It's called Revolution in Color. You can get it in the bookstore. And Jane begins her first line of the book. She says about John Singleton Copley, the great Boston artist, that he grew up facing the sea. You know, he was born in Boston in, I think, 1739, the same year that this painting that I was just showing was complete. He was born in 1738. This is also a painting, A View of Boston by John Smybert. Now, Copley and his parents lived on Long Wharf, which is the long wooden wharf that jutted out into Boston Harbor. It's this long appendage here sticking out into the harbor. And you can see Boston, a fairly small city even at this stage, but surrounded by ships. And this idea of the transatlantic world, that Copley grew up facing the sea, that his ambitions and those of his patrons related to the growing mercantile economy in Boston, and the way that Boston, as well as other ports on the eastern seaboard, were connected in this growing world of mercantilism and trade. We see other port cities in this era look very similar. This is a view of Newport, Rhode Island, painted 2 years later in 1740, showing the harbor at Newport, again, you know, surrounded by ships in the harbor, evocative of the kind of the growing economy in Newport. And I want to point your attention to what is the northern part of the city of Newport. A lot of you have been to Newport, I presume. And if you've been to Newport, you might have spent a little time in this neighborhood, right here on the left side of the painting, which is called Easton's Point, or folks in Newport just call it the Point. It was settled beginning in the 1710s. It was originally Quaker land, and the Quakers started to sell off the lots. And the folks who moved in the 1710s and 20s were initially shipwrights, which makes sense, they're right on the harbor, but also furniture makers. And by the end of the 18th century, the Point, which is this little area here, was home to dozens and dozens of some of the best furniture makers working in colonial America, as well as shipwrights. The shipwrights tended to purchase the lots right on the water, here and here, and then the furniture makers filled in this area, generally speaking. And there were other craftsmen as well, but there was an incredible concentration of both merchants, but also these furniture makers who were making furniture, some for the export trade. That'll become important in a moment. So, again, no better image of the transatlantic world than in the beginning of the Art of the Americas wing. If you look to your right when you enter, you'll see this incredible painting by John Singleton Copley of Watson and the Shark, a view of Havana, Cuba, showing British and Spanish ships in port in the harbor at Havana. Havana was a much bigger city than Boston during the 18th century. And Havana, like Boston, London, were all connected in what we know as the triangular trade, which is really more of a rectangle, less of a triangle, that brought raw materials from the West Indies up to the English colonies up the eastern seaboard. They were converted to products that could be sold, that were sent to England. There was trade back and forth. Of course, the slave trade was a major part of this, bringing slaves from the west coast of Africa to the Caribbean, mostly to work the sugar plantations. But I show this map. This is a kind of a world map from the 15th or 16th centuries up until the 18th century, but showing, like, you know, how the world is interconnected through seaborne commerce. It was much easier to move around in this period by water than it was by land. That's a critical fact to understand this period, that your town wanted to be right on the water because you could easily get up and down the coast, but to go overland in an era when there weren't that many roads, especially in North America, you can see why the world is developing, basically facing the sea, as Jane Kaminsky says. And another favorite painting of mine, John Singleton Copley's Boy with a Flying Squirrel, this was painted in 1765 as kind of a letter, in a way, sent to the Royal Academy in London to show off Copley's painting prowess, and it was eventually displayed at the Royal Academy and kind of gained his entrance into this august painting academy in London. And he puts a cup of water on the table, which is really interesting. You know, water is very difficult to paint, of course, but some scholars have read this as a body of water, and then, you know, maybe the Atlantic Ocean, and seeing Copley's great ambitions to cross the Atlantic to the old world. So all of this trade across the oceans, all these far-flung cultures that are being brought together right in this moment, led to a great deal of paperwork. Paperwork was obsessive in the 18th century. This is a photograph I took in some of the archival research that I do in my own work. There were tons and tons of letters being written. As a merchant, you had to keep track of all of these far-flung accounts for the first time. Your business was not just a local business anymore, but the very successful merchants had to send letters back and forth across the Atlantic, down into the Caribbean, to try to keep track of their all their business operations. Ledger books were kept to keep accounts straight, accounts of debits and credits that were coming back and forth. And you had to keep all of these papers organized and under lock and key oftentimes because they represented basically your worldly possessions. This interest in letter writing in the 17th and 18th centuries led to what is known to historians as the Republic of Letters. The Republic of Letters is a term that actually was coined probably as early as the 15th century, but it came into widespread usage in the 17th and 18th century, and it basically refers to this society of intellectuals, both in Europe and America, who traded letters back and forth. And it wasn't really a physical thing, it was a metaphysical thing, in the sense that it was an idea more than it was a place. And this Republic of Letters developed mostly in the European capitals. In Paris was especially home to a lot of intellectuals. They would meet sometimes once a week, sometimes every day of the week, in salons often run by women in Paris, and they would trade ideas, and they would try to encourage other people to join this Republic of Letters. And it's also the moment, after the printing press, that pamphlets and books and tracts were sent in vast quantities across the Atlantic to the New World. And that's, you know, it's kind of embodied by George Berkeley here, you know, carrying his books and then giving his books away to Harvard and Yale in 1731. So this Republic of Letters was based on this idea of letter writing, but it also was concurrent with the founding of several intellectual societies in Europe. One of the first was the Royal Society in London that was founded in 1662. It was a place for intellectuals to gather and talk and to perform scientific experiments and keep up to date with the latest findings, both in science, philosophy, and in literature. And in the Americas, we see similar kinds of societies or academies being founded around the same time. I think that one of the first was the Library Company of Philadelphia that was founded in the 1730s. And I show on the screen the Redwood Library in Newport, which was founded in 1747, with a beautiful building designed by the English architect Peter Harrison that was completed in 1750. And this is the old part of the Redwood Library. It's a spectacular building. If you have not had a chance to go inside, I encourage you to visit it in the city. It was the first Palladian building built in America with these wonderful columns, the four columns in the front of the building, and this rusticated facade. It's made of wood, but it's made to look like stone. Actually, I'm going to back up for a second. Notice the columns in the back of this painting of George Berkeley, and it's the same, you know, really it's the same moment that we see architecture in America being built in a very similar way. We see men like Benjamin Rush in Philadelphia being painted. This is in the 1780s, where he's seated at a writing desk and writing a letter. This is where we get the term a man of letters. It's right in this moment. And a man of letters was distinguished from an illiterate man. And initially, there were just these two categories. You were literate or you were illiterate. But in the 18th century, we start seeing the term man of letters being applied to intellectuals and men of science and philosophy, like Benjamin Rush here. This was painted by Charles Wilson Peale. And I have a quote here I want to read to you by Benjamin Rush. He's writing about his future wife. And when he first met her, she was a girl of only 17 years old, and he described her as engaging in her manners and correct in her conversation. But it was a letter he read by her that made her irresistible. And he says, quote, I had seen a letter of her writing to Mrs. Ferguson, which gave me a favorable idea of her taste and understanding. From this moment, I determined to offer my hand in marriage. So it was just based on her letter, which was a sign of her gentility, or her knowledge, and her understanding, as he says, that he was convinced that he needed to marry her immediately. It's also in this moment when we start to see books about writing and about the formation of letters being traded and circulated widely throughout the Atlantic world. And this is one of the most famous ones. It's called The Universal Penman. It was written by George Bickham, and it was published in a series of pamphlets beginning in the 1730s, and it was finally completed in 1741. And it literally was a guidebook on how to write, how to form letters. And it's also kind of an etiquette manual as well. And Bickham writes about the act of writing. And I'll read a quote that I have on your handout here. He says, a good hand will give to writing what we admire in a fine gentleman, an easiness of gesture and disengaged air, which is imperceptibly caught from frequently conversing with the polite and well-bred. So you have to hang around with well-bred and polite people, and you will have this disengaged air of a gentleman, which is then reflected in the way that you actually write letters. In the 1660s, writing schools developed in Boston. The earliest was in 1667. A school by William Howard was founded. And then in the first two decades of the 18th century, there were more than a dozen freelance writing instructors here in the city of Boston, and there were many in the other cities of North America. So polite people learn to form their letters as they learn to form their phrases and their sentiments. Conversely, bad handwriting could negatively impact the impression that you gave to others. There's a quote of a man who's complaining about the bad handwriting of his son, and he says, it's neither the hand of a man of business nor a gentleman, but of a truant schoolboy. So Bickham shows how to write letters and then how to use various kinds of script. One of the kinds of script is known as the Italianate hand or the Italian hand, and that's what you see on the screen. It's also sometimes referred to as round hand, which is a slight variant of Italian hand. And so there are examples of how to write all these different letters, and then an example of how to address a letter, this one written August 30th of 1740, signed your most obliged humble servant, George Bickham, at the bottom. These kind of manuals were used to teach children both how to write and how to properly speak and converse through letters. This is a painting in the MFA's collection, painted by Gilbert Stuart in 1773, of the children of Godfrey Malbone, a very wealthy merchant in Newport. His two sons, Francis and Saunders Malbone, were clearly trained in the art of letter writing at a very early age, and they're shown sitting at a Newport table. The older brother is writing a letter, and the younger brother is kind of has his hand to his face, and he's holding a book in his other hand. And they have, of course, instruments for writing in the center, a quill pen, a bottle of ink, a candle, which is always important, or a candle holder, and then what is probably a little sander. So ink didn't dry very quickly in these days, as it does today. So oftentimes, after you'd finish a letter, you'd sprinkle sand over the ink, and it would just absorb the extra ink. And sometimes you could just leave it, or sometimes you could kind of like brush it away. In those records that I showed earlier that I've researched, when they were often folded up into little packets in the 18th century and then filed away. And then when the archivist would bring them out, we'd open them up for the first time since the 18th century, and all this black sand would fall out of the letters, which is always kind of fun to see that happen. So Philip Dormer Stanhope, the Earl of Chesterfield, wrote in 1749, style is the dress of thoughts. If your style is homely, coarse, and vulgar, they will appear to as much disadvantage and be ill-received as your person, though even so well-proportioned, would, if dressed in rags, dirt, or tatters. So the act of writing, the formation of letters, was critical to your appearance to the outside world. And with all this work that I've done in the archives, I've learned very well to read some of the early script. And it's right at this moment, at the end of the 17th century, turning into the 18th century, that writing changes dramatically. And we move from what's called secretary hand, which is I show an example on the left, which is kind of an old script, moving to the Italian hand, or the Latinate hand on the right side. It's much easier to read the Italian hand. We're much more used to that today. But the secretary hand had been around for a couple of hundred years. It developed out of Old English. So you don't have Gothic letters anymore. It's kind of somewhere in between Gothic lettering and modern script. And so, you know, this is very, very complicated kind of writing. So I just show that there's a kind of a, as there is a refinement in dress and language and behavior, as some of these quotes have suggested right in this moment, there's also a refinement of writing. And when the founders of the country sat down to write the Declaration of Independence, they use a combination of these two kinds of script. We see at the top line, the unanimous declaration, that's written in Gothic lettering, which was still taught by Bickham in the 1730s and 40s. But the rest of the document is given over to this round hand or Italianate hand. And of course, John Hancock's signature in this Italianate hand is very prominent at the bottom of the document. And Benjamin Franklin, who presided over some of the founding of the new American nation, he was also involved in letter writing at a very early date. And in 1748, he actually published a book about handwriting. It was really basically a copy of an earlier English manual that was written by George Fisher, and it's called Young Man's Best Companion. So Franklin republished this as The American Man's Best Companion, and it was a whole treatise about writing and handwriting styles, and he actually introduced what's called round hand in this book, which became very popular in America. We see letters appearing, you know, all kinds of, in very prominent places in portraits. This is Samuel Adams, of course, in the MFA's collection. We see the same kind of script applied to the Liberty Bowl, which you've studied in depth last week, the kind of Italianate or round hand, a symbol of gentility. But on the other side of the bowl, we see references to letters, the letters of John Wilkes, the number 45, Liberty, and so forth. These kind of, this is part, very much part of the Republic of Letters, and a lot of the revolutionary ideals had actually come to America via letters and via these published pamphlets and other tracts. So there was also a different kind of writing in this moment that was very important. And I show on the screen John Singleton Copley's portrait of John Hancock from 1765. Now, John Hancock was a very wealthy and powerful merchant, and he's shown not writing a letter at his table, but instead he's keeping his ledger or account books. And I'm going to show you a detail here of his ledger book that Copley has so carefully delineated so that the viewer will know exactly what's going on here. And you can see the red lines that come down the right side of the page and also the left side of the page, and there's all these accounts with values at the end of them. And John Hancock, like every other merchant who is working in this era, worked in the same kind of way to keep the accounts. And I show an example. This is from 1804, but it looks like anything you'd see during the 18th century. There were four different kinds of account books that were used in this period. There were day books that you'd keep track of what's going on each day, but the really important thing was the ledger book like this, which was the kind of the final list of all the charges and debits and credits that were going back and forth. Now remember that in this period, there are no banks. This is a cash-poor society. There's very little cash circulating, and there's very little silver circulating. People, you know, their whole personal wealth or their business wealth was tied up in all of these accounts that were going back and forth between different craftsmen and patrons and craftsmen and patrons and artists. And I'll show this here just says library. The DR here means debit. This is the date here, and then the month and day with all the lines of whatever is being you know, cash is being given for something here, and then this is the total amount, which is then added up here. So all these account books work in a very similar way. And I show on the screen a very famous account book that was just discovered fairly recently and led to a wonderful exhibition on Nathaniel Gould at the Peabody Essex Museum just a couple of years ago. And the discovery of this account book of a furniture maker, you know, gave us incredible amount of information about how business was transacted during the 18th century. And I'll just show, you know, just two pages out of the book. The left side are all the debits, and the right side are the credits. So the left side will say a quantity of chalk, which was sold to the furniture maker Nathaniel Gould. Here's an amount of plank boards. Here's sugar, cash, lent, other things, all the way down the page. And so this are all the out. This is the outflow of money going out of the account book, and the inflow is on the right side. Here are the credits, the CR credits here. And the credits are to making a desk in June of, I think, I don't know exactly the date, making a desk, making a cedar desk, a pair of candlesticks, making another cedar ditto, which is candlesticks, and then making a mahogany and maple desk here. This is a lot of desks. Probably he's making these to be sold. He's not making them for the patron, Gideon King, whose name is on the left, but he's actually making things to be marketable and to be kind of shipped out and sold. So, you know, this was it was a really important that you kept your ledger books, because if you lost your ledger book, that was over. You know, you'd go bankrupt practically. So it was very, very critical. And there's lots of court cases in the 18th century that revolve around these scraps of paper that were the receipts from the ledger book. Let's say somebody doesn't pay up at the end, which happened very frequently. The other person would have to take them to court, and then they would present to the judge and the jury all of the different scraps of paper that were gathered from the office. And they would sometimes bring in their ledger books, and then the scribe in the court would copy down all of the relevant lines from the ledger book. And so in the court records that I've researched, we see a lot of these ledger book transactions. But anyway, it's important to keep things straight, which is why ledger books show up so prominently in very important paintings of individuals in the 18th century. This is a very famous painting that's at the Metropolitan Museum of Art, painted in 1789 by Ralph Earle, a Connecticut artist, of Elijah Boardman, who was a dry goods merchant in Connecticut. And we see his writing desk or his office desk. It's a standing desk, like Donald Rumsfeld used a standing desk. So this is like the 18th century version of a standing desk. It's come back in fashion. A lot of people use them today. And it's covered with green baize. You can see his quill pens up on the left side, probably his ledger book on the top. And then on the bottom, which could be ledger books, but actually I think this is meant to represent his library, because on the spines of a lot of the books, we see the titles of them, and they're, you know, works by Shakespeare and Milton and other luminary writers. I can't imagine a craftsman having, or even a merchant having, his library on the bottom of his office desk. But anyway, it could be kind of artistic license. But it is important that the ledger book here would have been kept very safe. You wouldn't have left all your ledger books out for, you know, for anybody to take. There's no way. You definitely keep them behind lock and key. And another very important painting, which you probably know well, which is Nicholas Boylston by Copley, painted in 1769. There's another version of this painting over at the Harvard Art Museums. And it shows Nicholas Boylston, who was a very wealthy merchant here in Boston in the 18th century. He's shown not in his office, but he's shown at home. And he's wearing a long banyan coat, a silk banyan coat. He's at home, he's not out in public, so he's taken off his wig, which he would have worn in public, and he's revealed his shaved head underneath, and to keep his head warm, he's wearing a soft cap. So what he's wearing is very indicative of what a man of wealth and status would have worn at home, not in the office, which is interesting because Copley also alludes to his wealth as a merchant, because his arm is resting on his ledger or account books here. And that's just enough. For an 18th century viewer, that's just enough to know that he's a merchant. He's clearly very successful. And then the source of his wealth, the sea, or the mercantile trade, is shown behind him with this view of what's probably Boston Harbor. So now we're going to get into writing desks. This is this new form of furniture that develops right in this moment as a response to the need for all these letters to be written and also all these accounts to be kept. And the earliest desks were very simple, very small objects. They were basically simple boxes. Some of the most elaborate of them had a slant lid, which allowed the user to write on it. And I'm going to fast forward just a second. The box I show on the left is an English box in the collection of the Victoria and Albert Museum. And I show an image on the right of a man using a very similar desk. And you can see he's kind of resting his arm on the desk, and he's leaning over it to write. And he's using specifically the right side of the desk to write his letter. And you can see here that this desk has a little ledge here, which is meant to keep the paper on the desk surface. But this is open, so that would be a place for you to read. So clear, a right-handed desk, I guess this would be called in this period. Other similar images of writing. A much earlier painting on the left, but showing a very similar slant-lid writing desk that was very popular for hundreds of years, beginning from the medieval period onward. The form really didn't change very much. And then, of course, a famous painting by Vermeer, but showing a woman seated at a table and with a table cover, probably a velvet table cover over the table, and she's writing her letters right on that. I mean, paper was a lot thicker in these days, and you didn't have to push so hard with the quill pen, so it would have been possible, I think, to write on a velvet cover just like that, because you see so many images of people working in this period in a very, very similar manner. And you can see she has a small box behind her on the table, which could be a writing box or a box for valuables. So this form of a slant top box emerges a little bit larger in the beginning of the 18th century in America and a little bit earlier in England and other parts of Europe. So basically, this is your slant lid box here at the top. And it's just been set on top of a chest of drawers. And they often have 2 feet. In the earlier period, they have turned ball feet just like this. And the inside is given over to all these little small compartments for storing your papers and your quill pens and your sanders and all those things you needed to store. And also little cubbies for folding up letters and accounts. So it's a pretty small object. You couldn't have put ledger books there, but you could have certainly kind of use this to organize some of your smaller papers. And I just show the outside of the desk. These objects are very fancy. In this example here, it's made of a new type of a craft that's developing right in this period that's called veneering, where they take very, very thin sheets of precious wood. In this case, this desk is made probably of imported walnut. It's made in Rhode Island, but the walnut that they used for the veneering actually probably was shipped in from the mid-Atlantic colonies like Virginia or Maryland, for example. And so this imported wood was very costly. So they would take just thin slices of that veneer and put the veneer on top. So you'd see from the outside this really fancy, elaborate, really swirly walnut. There's also another kind of writing desk that's not really popular in England, but it is popular in Germany and in Spain, which is called a writing cabinet, which is a writing box, but it has lots of little drawers and cubbies on the inside to keep, could have been keeping writing utensils, but it also could have been used to keep valuables under lock and key. These are also very fancy objects. Many times they're veneered with marquetry and parquetry. So these two forms that evolve into the small desk then grow a little bit in the early 18th century to what we call a desk and bookcase, where they basically added a bookcase section on top of a slant-lid writing desk. So now we're kind of building up here. And this particular example was owned in the Avery family here in Boston, a wealthy merchant family. It was donated in the 20th century by the Carolyn Martha and Maxime Karolik to the MFA. And I just point out on the outside, you see these beautiful stars. These are called starites. They're kind of mariner stars in a way. So just the outside of the desk, kind of just the iconography of it kind of speaks to this transatlantic mercantile world that's developing in the early 18th century. The outside is walnut, again, probably imported from the mid-Atlantic. And then the brasses that are used for the escutcheons, for the locks, and also the handles, those are also imported as well, probably made in England and imported into Boston, then were cleaned up and put on the desk. So basically, everything on the outside of the desk kind of speaks to this transatlantic world, the imported woods and the imported brasses. But the inside is where all the action takes place on this object. So the upper bookcase section has the same kind of small cubbies that you see in the earlier writing desks, but then you have these long, very narrow and slender openings in the center. What are these used for? The ledger books, right. And the ledger books would have slid right into these drawers. Then you would have kept letters and other smaller documents in these smaller drawers and maybe some writing utensils up here in the bookcase section here. Down here is basically an elaborated version of the interior of the desk we looked at a moment ago. I mean, the interior of the desk we looked at a moment ago is a little bit earlier, maybe 10 years earlier, and this is about 10 years later, but they're essentially made roughly around the same time period. But you get this incredible, almost theatrical inside of the desk, really elaborately made. So this is, you know, I think of this as like the 18th century version of an office. You know, you could have sat here to write your letters and to respond to correspondence, and then you would have organized all your papers here. This upper section, it is a bookcase, so you could have kept library books in a way up there, but it's really for ledger books. And that, as I mentioned before, in an era where there are no banks, this is your bank. So the upper section is your bank, the middle section is your office, and what's the lower section for? For clothes, exactly, for clothes. It's, as I mentioned before, it's a chest of drawers. This is a small chest of drawers, but they get much bigger in the 18th century. And this is for keeping what was probably the most valuable thing in your household, which were your clothes and your textiles. Very, very fine cloth, often imported, was very, very costly in this period. So you get your bank, your workstation, and your closet all wrapped up into one piece of furniture, which is like, you know, it's a new invention right in this moment. What's really interesting about this particular example are the insides of the doors. Do you see how they're a slightly different color than the wood around them? So I'm going to show you a detail here. The person who owned this desk, presumably, probably in the first half of the 18th century, started to write out these phrases, and they pasted them on the insides of the doors. So what are these phrases? We see liberty here. It's a little hard to see because they've used a kind of colored ink. It's red, and it's kind of faded over time. But you get all these like curly cues around, which we've been seeing before. And then there are these poems about liberty here. And the other one speaks about commerce. And again, these poems here. And I can't quite read it all, but it says, "Our trade extended as far as winds can blow." So this is about mercantile culture and commerce, but also about liberty. Well, where are they getting these phrases? Well, they're getting them right out of George Bickham's The Universal Penman, which was, as I mentioned, written between 1733 and 1741. And so these are the pages that relate to liberty. And you can see liberty is written in the Italian hand here, but also in kind of a different, not quite a Gothic hand, but something in the middle here. And that's the kind of lettering that you see over here. And the poems are fairly related. And here's the section about commerce. And again, notice the lettering of commerce and how it's shown in the page. And this is exactly what you see written on the desk, this part here. This is the same poem, and I don't want to read it, but you know, it talks about mercantile culture and all the wonders that it brings, and then it ends with the line, "And from the rich mountains of Peru are thine." Like, we can own even the rich mountains of Peru because we're merchants and we have access to all these things that our forefathers did not. So this is a pretty interesting desk and bookcase. So the desk and bookcase is on view in the lower level of the Art of the Americas wing. The doors are not open, but you get a sense. I've shown you a little bit of the inside of this object. So these desks developed during the course of the 18th century into really, really elaborate objects that would have been among the most expensive things in one's household. They're often made of imported woods, like the earlier walnut. In this case, this was not made of walnut, but this is made of mahogany. It's made a little later in the 18th century. This desk and bookcase was actually made by Nathaniel Gould, whose account book I showed earlier, and this piece was on view at the Peabody Essex Museum as part of this amazing show. And it's one of my favorite pieces of furniture. It's very architectural in style. It looks like a little building in a way. So the concepts of Palladian architecture that you see embodied in the Redwood Library, which is built around 1750, continue on in furniture making through the course of the 18th century. And this is a wonderful example of that. We see other kinds of desks and bookcases made. This is a beautiful example that's owned by the Yale University Art Gallery. We've learned recently that it was made in, not in Newport, Rhode Island, but in Providence, Rhode Island, by this man named Daniel Spencer in the 1770s to the 1790s, and it was owned by John Brown, who was a very prominent merchant in Providence, Rhode Island, where this desk was made. And John Brown and his three siblings owned a group of these very, very tall desk and bookcases, made of mahogany, made with the characteristic Rhode Island block and shell feature, where you see the shells, kind of symbolic of mercantile culture, but then mixed with the English-style blocking, which is this undulating facade that ripples through the upper and the lower cases. And the last one of these that sold at auction, which was in 1990, quite a number of years ago, sold for $12.1 million. To give you a sense that even today, we still value these remarkable, complex objects. And some of the reasons why these things are so valuable today is the level of craftsmanship that's put into these. And I just show the interior of a desk and bookcase from Newport that we have down in our galleries. If you go to, we have a Rhode Island furniture gallery in the Art of the Americas wing, and we have two of these spectacular desks and bookcases on view, and one is opened up so you can see the interior of it. So I just took a quick snapshot of it, but you can see all these spaces, these graduated spaces for ledger books at the bottom, smaller books, and then letters and other things at the top. So the MFA, we have a lot of amazing desks in the collection. We don't often buy new desks, but this remarkable object came on the market a few years ago in 2013. It came up at a Skinner auction just outside of Boston. That particular auction was in Marlborough, Massachusetts, and it was listed in the catalog as being from Philadelphia, 1700 to 1710. And right at the time when this thing came on the market, I was working on an exhibition project at the Yale Art Gallery focused on Rhode Island furniture making. And I was looking right at this early period in the 18th century as part of my job for this project, and had been studying quite a bit of this furniture. And so we took one look at this thing and said, this isn't from Philadelphia. This is from Rhode Island. This has to be from Rhode Island, based on some of the construction details, some of the secondary woods that are used, like chestnut, for example, and particularly the veneering on the outside of the cabinet. So these kind of paneled veneers that you see here, and the kind of veneers that you see on the drawers. It's like the Avery family desk that I showed earlier, but just not quite as elegant. But it is quite English in style. It's actually based on an English form that's called either a scriptor or an escritoire, or some kinds a scrutoire, which basically means to write, script, to write. So a scriptor is a writing desk, and this is another kind of variant of desk that's made beginning in the late 17th century, but then into the early 18th century in America. And while the lower section has this very large chest of drawers for storing clothes or other things at the bottom, the upper section has a fall front lid and all these little cubbies and drawers for papers like we've seen before. So we have an English example of a scriptor or escutoire in the MFA's collection. This is a piece that was made probably around 1700. We don't have a great photo. We just have a black and white photograph of it, but it's very similar in style. So clearly the man who made the desk in Rhode Island either was trained in England or was very familiar with English furniture making traditions. It turns out that this particular form is extremely rare in America. There were only two known before the auction. With the auction, there were three known. And this one is one of the more well-known examples. This was made in Philadelphia, Pennsylvania, and it's dated 1707, and there's a stamp on it from the maker, Edward Evans. He was a well-known furniture maker in Philadelphia in the period. And having the date on this so clearly is useful because it helps us date the piece that came on the market. So kind of putting it closer to the early part of the 18th century. So this is a walnut example made by Edward Evans in Philadelphia. And the other example is the Brinkerhoff escutoire or scriptor that was made a little bit later, probably in the 1720s maybe. It's tall and narrow as opposed to being wide and squat, and the tall, narrow proportions suggest that it was made a little bit later. And it also has this incredible inlay of vine and berries that just cover the surfaces of the outside and the inside. It's a lovely piece of furniture. So number three comes on the market. We think it's Rhode Island based on some of the construction techniques. So then we go to the auction to look at it and opened up the drawer, and there's a Rhode Island newspaper stuck to the inside of the drawer, and this is I think it's July 1st of 1825 issue of the Rhode Island American, which is a newspaper that was published in Providence. So that was helpful. That was kind of nice to see. We also noted that the secondary woods that the drawers are made of is chestnut, which is a wood that's very commonly used by furniture makers in Rhode Island. So the other thing about this desk is that it had a really good family history. In fact, it was being sold right out of the original family that had owned it since the 18th century. It was being sold from the Child family of Rhode Island. And the Child family lived in northern Rhode Island, and the last descendant who owned this piece lived just outside of Providence. So Rhode Islanders don't ever go very far. I mean, basically, it had moved like 10 miles in one direction in 300 years. So that was kind of cool. So we had this early Rhode Island history going back to the 18th century. So I started to trace back through the family, and I was able to find this piece listed in the inventory of this man named James Child. And the inventory was taken in 1738. And in 1738, James Child lived in the town of Swansea, Massachusetts. Now, if you know anything about the border wars between Rhode Island and Massachusetts going back to the 18th century, in 1747, Rhode Island annexed the eastern side of the Narragansett Bay, and all of those towns became incorporated into the colony of Rhode Island. This is 1747. So all these towns, Bristol and Tiverton, Little Compton, and Warren up here at the top, these are all taken from Massachusetts and given to the Rhode Island colony. And Swansea, Massachusetts, is a big, you know, town that is basically here, and the western side of Swansea was taken by Rhode Island and then given the name of Warren. So that's now the town of Warren, Rhode Island. And it's in that part of Swansea where the Child family lived, right on the water. In fact, they were big shipbuilders during the 18th century, very wealthy. You can tell by, you know, owning a piece of furniture like this. And so this is in the 1738 inventory, and this is the line right here. It says, one chest of drawers and cabinet. How else would you describe something like this? It's a great description. A chest of drawers and a cabinet. And it's valued at £5, which is basically the most expensive piece of furniture in the entire inventory. So here's the inside, again, of this scriptor. It's a really remarkable object, really complex in its details and so forth. So we go to the auction, and we start to examine it. We want to look at all the surfaces, so we start pulling out the drawers, and we quickly get a pile of drawers on the tabletop. Behind all the visible drawers, there are secret compartments and secret drawers. So here at the top, you can see this box has been removed, and then behind it is a secret drawer with a little cotton pull so you can pull it out. And there are labels on each of the drawers here telling them what was inside. Now, we didn't find anything inside, but we do have all these labels here and all these little secret drawers. So we start pulling drawers, and the drawers keep coming, and they keep coming, and they keep coming. And here's me at the auction, bent over 25 secret drawers that we found hidden in all the nooks and crannies of the desk. 25 secret compartments. There's about 50 total compartments in this thing, 46 compartments in the uppercase alone. And half of those are visible. The other half, even more than half, are actually secret. And we tried to arrange them on the floor so we didn't get them out of order. There were just so many drawers coming out of this thing. It was incredible. Now, it's not uncommon to find secret drawers. I mean, it's uncommon to find secret drawers, but you do see them made in America. But typically, you'll get one or two, maybe three secret compartments. The most I'd ever heard of was 14, which is on an order of magnitude greater than anything else that's known. And this has 25 secret compartments. It's really remarkable. So we brought this back to the MFA. We had our furniture lab and our conservators do a diagram of the locations of all the secret compartments. And you can see them hidden behind the upper section here, down the middle section. That's the picture photograph I showed you. But then what's really cool is that they're hidden down the sides of the case itself. Like, when you open it up, you wouldn't necessarily recognize that that was actually a drawer. There's no handle on it. You'd have to just see that there's a slight gap between the drawer and the case itself, so you have to stick your fingernail in there and just get it loose and pull it out. It's quite difficult to get inside them. And then underneath, there's what's called a ledger drawer. So the ledger drawer slides off the top. It basically forms the upper part of the desk surface. It's just a little panel. The panel slides out, and then underneath is a secret drawer. You take out that secret drawer, which is here, and then there is one, two, three, four, five, six drawers hidden behind it that you only can see once you've taken the central compartment out. It's really a remarkable thing, incredible example of the craft of cabinet making in the early 18th century. So I mentioned on a lot of these secret compartments, we found inscriptions. And on the side drawers, on the right side of the case, we found names of certain children of the child family written in the late 18th century. So here we see Abigail Child. This is Gardner Child, June 1795. This says Samuel Child. And this says Nathan Child. And so Nathan, Samuel, and Abigail were siblings, and Gardner was their cousin. And they all lived in this town of Warren in the late 18th and early 19th century. So presumably, you know, they each had their own little secret drawer where a parent or an uncle perhaps kept what was valuable to them, whatever that was. And there's all kinds of other inscriptions on this desk. They're in ink, they're in pencil, and they're also in chalk. And so chalk was used as really a quick method of writing something down, and you didn't mean it to last. But the good thing about chalk is it actually sticks in place on wood fairly well, and even for hundreds of years, it'll stay in place. And sometimes, even when it's brushed away, the fact that it's covered a little bit of that wood for, let's say, 100 or 200 years, the wood around it will oxidize more and darken over time, but the wood underneath the chalk won't oxidize, so it tends to be lighter. So even if the chalk is gone, sometimes you can read what was originally written there. In this case, of this drawer, the chalk is still very much there, and it says, received books, basically ledger books, February something, 1804. So this is, you know, this drawer was for keeping books of some kind of ledgers or accounts. And then we see a very, very faint inscription here in ink. And it's in an area where, in the central part of the desk, that somebody had placed a label over it at a later date and then removed the label and kind of wiped away the glue. So this is an ink inscription that was under glue that had been wiped away. And so we lost most of the inscription. But with regular light photography, we were able to kind of see that there was something here. There's a word here, and there's a word here, and there's a word here. But very difficult to read. So as part of my research for this Rhode Island project at Yale, which I mentioned before, I did a lot of work in the archives, and we discovered about 2,000 names of furniture makers who were active during the 17th and 18th centuries in the colony of Rhode Island. 2,000 makers. When we started the project, we knew of about 350. And then once we dug into the archives, we found another over 1,500 more names of all these furniture makers. So I went to my list of Warren and Swansea furniture makers and house carpenters, and here is a list of names. We've got Benjamin Barton, Ebenezer Cole, Charles Easterbrook, and then Thomas Easterbrook, a bunch of them, probably siblings or cousins, Kennicott, Luther, Salisbury, Smith, Sewell, and Wheaton, all these different guys that we had found various bits of evidence about, and most of them are working more or less in the period when the desk was made, probably a little bit on the later side. So then going back to this inscription, our conservation lab photographed it under UV light, which tends to pull out the graphite and also ink inscriptions fairly well. It was pretty hard to see, but here's this first word here, and here's the second word here, and there's the third word. And then there's a Thomas right here that's more easily seen. And this Thomas is written kind of in that old secretary hand. Remember that hand that I showed earlier in the lecture that's a little bit hard to read? This is not quite, this hasn't evolved out of secretary just yet into round hand. So this is kind of, it speaks to a pretty early date for this inscription based on all the reading that I've done. So then we pulled this out even further using different lighting techniques and photography. And I started, this was hard to read, but then I saw an E here, E. That looked like an S to me. This was definitely a T because there's something going up and there's something crossing it. There's something, something, and then you've got a stroke up here. This is a B, R, O, O, K. And I said, oh, I know that name. That's Thomas Easterbrook, is one of the names on our list that we had discovered from before. So here, there's Thomas and Charles. So all these guys are working as house carpenters, probably not, they're not at the level of making something so sophisticated as an escritoire like this with 25 secret compartments. But nevertheless, it's an interesting link to possibly craftsmen who are involved in making this object. So this piece is on view at Yale at the moment, at the Yale Art Gallery, in this show about Rhode Island, which is up until January 8th. So if you want to see it and you're passing through New Haven, Connecticut, please stop to see it. And then at some point in the future, we're going to put this piece on view here at the MFA. And hopefully we're going to try to have it open with some of the secret compartments pulled out so that you can see it. So this desk form becomes quite elaborate during the course of the 18th century, as we've seen. And the MFA has wonderful examples. This is among our most famous, made by George Bright, who was called the neatest craftsman in Boston in the 18th century. This was made as a gift for a wedding in 1792. It might actually date a little bit earlier, given the style of the piece itself, but the date of the wedding was 1792. And this is the inside of it. Just remarkable, just remarkable. And now you'll easily recognize all the compartments for the ledger books on the right side and probably library books in the middle, and letters at the bottom and at the very, very top. So there are other kinds of writing desks made in this period, some with interesting historical connections. And this particular, I wouldn't even call it a desk, it's really a table. It was made in the Boston area around 1760. It's made of mahogany, for an imported wood. It's very fancy, beautifully carved legs and carved claw and ball feet. And it is owned by the Massachusetts Historical Society, and it was given to them some years ago with a family history that tied it to the first African-American poet in America, Phyllis Wheatley. She published a volume of poems. The title is Poems on Various Subjects, Religious and Moral. It was the first book of poetry published by a black American. It was published in London in 1773, and this I'm showing on the right side, the frontispiece to this book of poems. And the image was engraved by the slave of Reverend John Moorhead of England. And this appeared in the book. And it says, Phyllis Wheatley, Negro servant to John Wheatley of Boston. And you can see her seated at a round-topped or oval-topped table writing her poetry. It's not quite like the table on the left, which is square-topped. And in form, it's more like a card table or a tea table that would have been quite common. And supposedly, her her master, her owner, this man named John Wheatley, possibly gave this desk to her sometime before her death in 1784. She was purchased as a slave in 1761, published this book of poems in 1773 from London, and dies in 1784. So somewhere in here, presumably she acquires this desk, which she used to write her poems. It's pretty remarkable. And then probably the American desk with the most famous history is this pretty humble writing box, which was made by Benjamin Randolph, a furniture maker in Philadelphia. It was commissioned by Thomas Jefferson when Thomas Jefferson was living in Philadelphia between the summer of 1775 and 1776. And this is the desk that he wrote the Declaration of Independence draft on. It's now owned by the Smithsonian Institution. And in fact, it was a desk of Jefferson's own design. Like he drew the plan for that. We don't have the plan, but we knew that he drew it. And he commissioned Benjamin Randolph to make this desk. And in 1825, he gives the desk to his grandson-in-law, a man named Joseph Coolidge Jr., who married Thomas Jefferson's granddaughter. And he writes, he wrote him a letter, and he says, "Thomas Jefferson gives this writing desk to Joseph Coolidge Jr. as a memorial of affection. It was made from a drawing of my own by Benjamin Randolph, a cabinet maker of Philadelphia, with whom I first lodged upon his arrival in the city in 1776. And he says, it's like the one I wrote the Declaration of Independence on, thus gaining strength with time, and may one day give imaginary value to this relic for its association with the birth of the great charter of our independence, written at Monticello, November 18th, 1825. So Joseph Coolidge writes back to Jefferson in thanks in 1826, and this is another quote that I've included on your handout, and it just so perfectly illustrates the uses of desks in this period. So Joseph Coolidge writes to Thomas Jefferson, "I remember that it has served you 50 years, been the faithful depository of your cherished thoughts, that upon it have been written your letters to illustrious and excellent men, that it has, in fact, been the companion of your studies and instrument of diffusing their results. I would fain consider it as no longer inanimate and mute, but as something to be interrogated and caressed." So Thomas Jefferson was a very well-known letter writer, and he used this desk for 50 years in writing his correspondence. There are about 20,000 letters that survive from Thomas Jefferson. That's an incredible amount of production. And he wrote many from his office here at Monticello. It's kind of his bedroom office. His bed is right on the right, and here's his office filled with surveying and scientific instruments, as well as various writing desks and tables and other things where he wrote these letters. And Thomas Jefferson actually started to lament the amount of letter writing he had to do. He called it pen and ink work, and he said, "I suffer under the persecution of letters," in a letter he wrote to John Adams in 1820. He says, "From sunrise to 1 or 2 o'clock, I am drudging at the writing table." So it became very difficult for Jefferson, especially as he got more elderly, and of course he was quite famous, so everyone was writing him letters and wanted a response. And so he actually invented a polygraph copying machine in 1806 to help him make copies or duplicates of his various letters that he's writing. So he holds one of the pens in his hand and the other one makes an exact replica of that letter on the other page. So this has been a quick romp through the form of writing desks that are kind of a newfangled thing in the 18th century, but you can see how their evolution begins around the beginning of the century and then evolves into something quite interesting. And I hope you've enjoyed this talk. Thank you so much. And I'm happy to take questions if you have any questions. Yes?
I have a question about the desk that you did so much work on. Did you buy it from Skinner and then begin making it sequentially? How does one go about as a museum
That's a very good question. The question was, how do we go about buying the desk or escritoire that I was talking about? And specifically, the process we go through and the timing of that process. So, like most auctions, we don't get a lot of advance warning. Like, we got the auction catalog, it was maybe 10 days before the auction. So we had to quickly identify it as something interesting. Then we had to go see it. We had to examine it at the auction house. Then we had to come back to the MFA and get our bosses interested in it enough so that we would raise the amount of money needed to be successful at the auction. And I can't remember exactly what the estimate was, but it was about $20,000 or $30,000. So we started to put our heads together and we started to think of a good price. Now, we knew more about this thing than anybody else, so we knew it was really important. But the last one that had sold for about $500,000, about $470,000. And it wasn't quite like that, but it was enough like it that we were worried that it was actually going to go very high. So we mustered our resources, and we bought it with Hammer. I think it was $270,000, which is not, it's half of what this other one had sold for. So I thought we got a good deal. And now I think it would be worth much more. Not that it matters, but now that we know so much more about it, and we've done all this research work. So we were only able to do a portion of that research prior to the auction. We knew enough to attribute it to Rhode Island. We knew about all the secret compartments, which Skinner hadn't found. They found some of them, but they didn't find all of them. And there was competition at the auction, but we were fortunately successful. And then I started to do more research into the child family, found it in the inventory, and then it was included in this Rhode Island exhibition, which was kind of underway at the time. So we knew it was a great opportunity, and it was an August auction at Skinner. It's the sleepiest auction of the year. No one's there because everyone's on vacation. So August auctions are great to find little hidden treasures, and we did, in fact, in 2013. Another question? Yes, in the front.
On the same desk, did you share with Skinner your conviction that it was not a Philadelphia piece, or
that's
did you keep that to yourself?
Well, that's a good question. They saw us like pulling this thing apart, and they knew who we are when we're there. We tried to do it kind of under the cover of darkness so that we're not recognized at the auction, and but there were some people kind of snooping around and listening into what we're talking about, and we just had to be open and talking about it. We didn't discuss it at great length with them. They only knew that we were interested in it, and that happens a lot at auctions. And we didn't want exactly for everybody to know it was Rhode Island. I don't know if that would have affected the price or not, but there was enough there were lots of people bidding against me. I'll say that. In the front again.
Thank you. You mentioned this that there are three of these full front. Our fall front desks, and the one with the vines and the berries, where is that? This
desk is at the Museum of the City of New York. I don't know if I'm going to go back fast enough, but the first desk by Edward Evans is owned by Colonial Williamsburg, and it can be seen. I'm not sure if it's in the galleries right at this moment, but here it is. And then the vine and berry one that you were asking about, that's owned by the Museum of the City of New York. Okay. And it's a great treasure. It's just a lovely object. It has incredibly refined proportions and inlay. And it's probably on the late side of as such things go. When other places are building desk and bookcases, like the Avery example we saw, which is very thin and elegant and very different in style, this remained popular, at least in New York, up until probably the 1720s.
Mm-hmm. And I want to say that I agree with you that the Peabody Essex show on Nathaniel Gould was one of the most interesting exhibitions I have ever seen in my entire life.
That's great. It was a great show.
It was fascinating, and also about his techniques, about how he came from New York, and he was one of the only people who knew certain styles, and so he never, he didn't employ anyone who was in Salem. he employed other people and he made them work in his own house and he charged them room and board up the gazoo so they didn't have any money to really go to the taverns.
He knew what he was doing.
I thought that was just fascinating. The other thing I wanted to say is this Jefferson writing box that you showed, it says it's owned by the Smithsonian, but I think I have seen it. I lived in Washington for a long time. I think I have seen it. I think it's now in the State Department reception rooms, which have many wonderful pieces of furniture. Perhaps you've been there.
I have been there. This is the diplomatic reception rooms at the State Department, which have been furnished in a 18th century American style. They have incredible objects. And you may well be right. I have been through a couple of times, but I just don't remember seeing it there. But that is actually a really good place in Washington for such a desk. I think it would get lost in the Smithsonian. For some time, the desk was on view at the American History Museum in the Hall of Presidents, and there was a big exhibition about presidents, and I know it was there for some time. I'm not sure where it is right at this moment, but it's a great relic of the Revolutionary era. In the back?
Yes, I'm interested in the standing desk. Exactly how were they writing and reading at these desks with the slanted? Was the slant just for reading, or did they actually write with a slant?
They did a lot of writing at the desk. I think mostly writing and less reading, because they're basically desks for office space. Mm-hmm. So you probably wouldn't be reading letters, but you wouldn't be reading a book or something on it. Mm-hmm. That would have been done in a chair or in a more of a private area, I would suspect. But it's mostly for working and composing and keeping. Accounts and so forth. It's hard. The slant lid is actually pretty comfortable to work on, but if you've got a lot of papers that you're trying to organize, it can be quite difficult. So a desk with a fall front is actually much easier for that purpose.
One back there, and then.
In the back, yes.
Was the desk that was sold before the Child's Family desk, the one that was so expensive, was that the Townsend Goddard desk that was sold in Providence?
You're thinking of the $12 million desk.
Okay.
That's the Nicholas Brown desk and bookcase that's now in a private collection. That the one that had set this other record was a Philadelphia fall front desk, but it had some alterations to it, so it wasn't quite exactly like the form I was talking about, but it was the only comparable recent auction estimate that we could go on, because the other two pieces have been in museums for many decades. So there really was no way to assess a value for such a rare object other than to try to find something that was close enough to it. So this thing that was almost $500,000, that was, again, a slightly different form. I believe is in a private collection as well now.
It's a little off topic, but I can't help but wonder how Rhode Island made the land grab.
Oh, that's a good question. Well, you know Rhode Islanders. Now, what happened is that eastern part of the Narragansett Bay was in such a close orbit with the big cities of Newport and Providence, and it was so far away from the big cities of southern east or southeastern Massachusetts, which are really on the eastern side. It was just kind of a rural area in this period, and there was so much connection via the waterways in the Narragansett Bay. Remember saying it was easier to get around by water? So it would be easier to get on a boat and go to Newport than it would be to go overland to another big city or to go to Boston, for example. So over time, the eastern side of the Narragansett Bay became really closely connected with the Rhode Island colony, even though officially it was part of Massachusetts. And Rhode Island, it still is the smallest state, even with this addition. It was really tiny to begin with. And it was the English king that actually made the assignment. They got enough counselors to convince the king to make this decree, and it was done in 1747. And the meeting for the incorporation of the town of Warren, Rhode Island, was held in the Child House, to show you how prominent they were in town, even by the 1740s. We don't know a whole lot about James and his father, John, who probably was the original owner of the desk. Just what we do know, though, suggests that they were very wealthy, very prominent in politics, and they also became shipbuilders at a later date. Yes?
So
Yeah. That's a good question. So I did the Made in the Americas exhibition that was here last year that took on a much more global focus to the colonial era and the connections between Asia and the Americas specifically. And then I had been working on this Rhode Island show for 15 years leading up to the opening. And it was something I had worked on when I was at Yale, but I've been here in Boston for 10 years, but I continued in the kind of the background doing things, and finally that's happening. So what am I going to do next? That's a good question. So I think my next two projects will be about Native American art. It's very different than what I've done before, but that's what keeps us going, and so I'm going to try to branch out a little bit and do something different. Thank you very much.
Thank you.